Hello everybody, it's time to go. I'm going to talk about how to make a zero downtime update of CloudFoundry applications with database migrations. My name is Tsvetan Tsokov and I am a software developer into SAP, making a lifecycle management of applications into the SAP Cloud Platform. More specifically, I'm working into the MultiApps project, which currently is into the CloudFoundry incubator, and we will mention it later. Okay, so let's imagine that we have one business application. It has a pretty straightforward architecture. It has a backing service, which is a relational database where we store our persistence data. We have a backend application which has some business functionality and uses the persistence data. And we have a web application which serves the web user interface. And let's also imagine that we have a lot of business customers and they are happy with our application, and after some uptime they want from us to implement new feature. When we implement the feature, come the question how to update the application. And also our business customers want the application to be highly available, and they don't want any downtime during the update. And on top of that problems, the feature also requires an incompatible change into the database. Everybody knows that every developer just loves incompatible changes. So the whole problem become how to make a zero downtime update of our application with incompatible changes into the database. This is rather a complex problem that doesn't have a solution into CloudFoundry and in general. And we at SAP are working on this problem and try to provide a solution for it. So prepare to see how we will make a zero downtime update of our application with an incompatible database change. So how can we make an update of application in CloudFoundry? We can simply update it with cf push command, or we could also use the blue green deployment approach. I assume that everyone of you know how the blue green deployment approach works. So let's directly apply it on our application. As you know, the first step is to deploy the blue version of the application. And the next step is to deploy the green version of the application with the updating also the database with the incompatible change. Having this incompatible change into the common database means that our blue version will stop work, and this leads to downtime, which is not so good for our customers. What is the change? Let's go deeper into the database and see it. We have a contacts table with ID, first name, last name, and some further columns. And we want to refactor the database. We want to merge the first name and last name columns into the full name column. This database evolution requires bulk migration of the existing data. So applying the blue green deployment approach on our application, we have two sub approaches. The first approach is the usual one. When we deploy the backend blue application, then deploy the backend green application and update the database with the green database structure and merging two columns. In this case, we break the backend blue version, which is downtime. The second approach is after deployment of the backend green application to not update the database. In this case, our blue version will continue to work, but the green one will be broken, which again leads to downtime. So, what are the problems here? Both versions of the applications cannot work in parallel with one common database. Also, we cannot revert to an older version in case of a bug in the new version. How can we solve this problem? Okay, instead of going with one giant step, we can apply several small steps to go from the initial to the final state. And we have to be sure that the consecutive versions are compatible between each other. In this case, we will enable the two versions of the applications to work in parallel with the common database, and we will enable the revert to an older version in case of a bug in the new one. So, let's see what are the steps here. The first step is to deploy our first version of the application with the table into the database. And also the first name and last name columns are set to not null. We have an API into the application for reading, writing and modification of the data. And after some uptime, some data is generated into the database. The next step is to deploy the next version of our application and add new nullable column, full name. Also, this new version of the app, the post and put requests write into the old and into the new columns in parallel. But the get requests still reads only from the old columns. Also, the full name, the new column full name is nullable. The next step is to run a one-off task on instance 0 of our application, which migrates the data from the existing columns to the new one. After this one-off task is finished, we should have a notification with the result. And if we are sure that the migration is okay, we can continue to the next step, where we start to read from the new column and set it to not null. The next step is to stop to write to the old columns and remove the not null constraint from them. Now, these old columns are not necessary anymore, and we can delete them in the final version. And in this case, we solve those problems. We have several consecutive versions which are compatible between each other, enabling both versions of the applications to work simultaneously, and enabling also a revert to an older one. But as you see, these steps are a lot. They require some custom migration scripts, which makes them really error-prone and difficult. Actually, nowadays, most of the operations teams are doing exactly this for achieving zero downtime updates of their applications. So, how can we solve all this complexity? Maybe you know who is David Weaver. He is a computer scientist who said that all problems in computer science can be solved with another layer of indirection, except for the problems of too many layers of indirection. So, obviously, we need another layer of indirection, or a database abstraction layer. The database abstraction layer will separate the application layer from the persistence layer, and it will provide database API gateway for the applications to use the persistence data. They also will hide complex database stuff like migrations from the applications. How can create database abstraction layer in different databases? Well, in SAP HANA, which is an enterprise database, we have the so-called projection views and synonyms. The projection views are the same as simple views, with the extension that they can access tables which are located in external databases. Synonyms also provide access to external objects, but not only tables, but all kinds of objects like sequences, procedures, stuff like that. Okay, but what about other popular databases like Postgres? Well, in Postgres we can use foreign data wrappers with foreign tables and additional database user with special permissions. In this case, we can implement database abstraction layer in different databases. It's necessary only the database to have to provide this functionality for making the abstraction layer. And having an abstraction layer, we could make a schema separation with two schemas: data schema and access schema. The data schema will contain database objects which are using persistence data like tables, sequences, and indexes. The access schema will have objects which are interfaces like views, synonyms, which we mentioned, and also logic with like procedures, functions, stuff like that. So in this case, the applications are bound only to the access schema and use it as a data source. They access data schema indirectly. Okay, so now we come the interesting stuff: how to handle the incompatible changes. In order to handle them, we should deploy into the data schema both versions of the database structure. In our case, we should leave the first name and last name columns to exist and add the full name column. And views in the Boo access schema will provide an API to the Boo version of the database structure, or only the first name and last name columns will be visible from the Boo access schema. Views in the green access schema will provide an API to the green database structure. So in this case, only the full name column will be visible from there. Also, in this case, the both versions of the application can work in parallel. And we also should deploy some triggers into a data schema which are making migrations between the columns in real time. Probably you are wondering who will handle these triggers, who will deploy them. For them, we should have a changelog file. The changelog file, currently we have a proof of concept of it. It currently has a JSON format. It has some data, metadata, and in it we describe our specific database evolution which we want to achieve. In our case, we are describing that we want to merge the first name and last name columns into the full name column, and with SQL statements we are defining the migration triggers. So now probably you're wondering who will handle this changelog file. It should be handled by a database module. The purpose of the database module is to deploy database objects into the data and access schemas, and to handle the database evolutions which we want to achieve. This database module will be bound only to the access and data schemas. And okay, but how to implement it? In SAP there is the so-called HANA deployment infrastructure, or HDI. It provides a declarative approach for defining database objects, also handling dependency management between these objects, and providing a consistent deployment model based on a transactional model. And you can think of it like it is really similar to Liquibase and Ruby Active Record migrations and other similar technologies. So for the implementation of our database module, we can use all of these technologies. So we know all the necessary parts. So now let's see the overall process. The overall process of the Blue Green deployment update is it is composed of three phases. The first phase is the install phase. In it, first we create our data schema, then our Blue access schema. Then we push our Blue database module, bound it to the data and access databases. Then run a one-off task on it, which deploys our Blue version of the database into access Blue and into the data schemas. Later we push our backend Blue application and bound it to the Blue access schema, so it uses it as a data source. And finally deploy our web Blue application and map an official route to it, so it is publicly available and our customers start to use it. So the next step is the update phase. In it we create our green access schema, push our green database module, bound it to the schemas, and run a one-off task on it, which gets the necessary database objects, the second version of them, parses the changelog file, creates all the necessary stuff into the data and access schemas, including the triggers, which are doing migrations at runtime. Also, during this step, the old existing data is migrated between the columns. And after this data migrations are done, we push our backend green application mapped to the access green schema. And finally, push our web green application, which is mapped to an temporary route, which is internally available. So after this phase, we can test our green application, and if it contains a bug, we can revert the process, or if we are okay with its quality, we can resume the process. Let's assume that everything is okay and resume the process to the final phase, where we switch the routes. So now our green versions are available on the official route. They are publicly available. So the UI of the customers is internally refreshed. New JavaScript is loaded, and they should not see any glitches, any downtimes during this switch. Next we start to undeploy the unnecessary Blue applications. And here we are making another one-off task on our green database module, which cleans up the necessary artifacts from the data schema. And finally, we remove the Blue access schema. So, as you see, here we have a lot of CF commands, a lot of steps, and luckily all these steps are automated by the MultiApps project. So let's explore it. But first, as you know, the current distributed applications can be composed of many polyglot microservices, backing services with complex dependencies between them. So the DevOps teams are responsible for installation, update, uninstallation, monitoring of all these distributed applications on different platforms with different versions. This is difficult task. It is addressed by the multi-target application model, which provides a declarative approach for description of distributed applications, which are sharing common lifecycle during development time and deployment time. So on the left side of the screen, you can see our applications with the backing services, and on the right side you can see the definition of these applications and services in a so-called multi-target application deployment descriptor, which has an YAML format. And also the multi-target application model requires that all of our binaries of the applications together with the deployment descriptor to be archived in a multi-target application archive. So having this archive, the MultiApps handle the lifecycle of our multi-target application. The MultiApps project consists of two parts. The first part is the CloudFoundry command line interface plugin, the MTA plugin. And the next part is that it has a backend application running into the platform. So the operator provides the MTA archive together with the deployment descriptor to the command line interface via the cfdeploy or cfpgdeploy command. And MultiApps installs all of our applications into the platform and manages its lifecycle. So our overall process with the blue-green deployment update, with the blue-green update, is automated in just three steps. The first step is to call cfbgdeploy with the first version of our hive, which deploys the blue version of the application. Next, we should call cfbgdeploy with the second version of our multi-target application archive, which deploys the second version of the application. Now it is available on the temporary route. We can test it. And if we are okay with the quality, we resume the process with the final command. For sure, we can also revert the process if it is not okay. So with these steps, we achieved the zero downtime update of our application. Okay, so let's go to the key takeaways. As we saw, the database evolution with incompatible changes is a complex task which has two solutions. The first one has many steps, custom migration scripts, and is really error prone. The second one needs an abstraction layer. And luckily, the MultiApps project makes and automates the whole process. Okay, together with my colleague, we have hands-on sessions today, which is finished. But tomorrow we also have a hands-on session and another election and also a project office hour. So if you want to know some more details about the MultiApps project, you can find us on these sessions. So thank you very much for attending my presentation. We have 5 minutes, so if you have questions, you can ask them. Thanks. Yes? Could you repeat the last part of the question?
If you have, why you could do more of this natively by just putting Liquibase in the app and having your SQL scripts, your Alter scripts, maybe your even migrate data scripts right in the SQL that you declare inside the app and kind of Liquibase or fly away. What are the challenges with that make you choose this other approach where you have a separate database module that you're running at the task? can you achieve this just with Liquibase or Flyway?
Okay, so the question is, could we integrate the Liquibase into the application itself, not using a separate database module?
Yeah, and achieve the same thing.
Okay, good question. So, the good part of the database module is that it has a separate purpose and functionality which it should handle, and we can manage it with different lifecycle separated from the applications. So it is more easy for this logic to be implemented in separate module, not in the applications itself, which the application's purpose is to have a business functionality, not to handle some database stuff. And this is a functionality which should be done by a separate module, which purpose is only to handle database stuff. And also the applications should know only about the access schema. They should not know anything about the data schema, because in the data schema we are doing complex logic like migrations and stuff like that. They should know only about the abstraction layer, not the database internals. So it is better the handling of the database objects to be in a separate module, which separate module now knows about the two databases and knows how to handle the database objects in the separate databases, in the access schema and in the data schema. And the database module is bound to this to both databases. It knows about both databases, not only the abstraction.
Is there an assumption that there may be other services using the same database, and that you might have to coordinate concerns about actual database changes with other services? Or are you assuming that this app is the only app that owns the schema? And so even if you choose to do it through a module and you separate, that it still has full domain over, like there's no coordination between this and some other team or some other apps that might be using it. What's the assumption that this app owns the database or that this other app's sharing it?
Okay, so the question is, what happens if the database is used by external services or other applications?
Well, not so much what happens, but what are you assuming? Are you assuming that only this app uses that database? Or that, I guess I'm getting at, you're not saying that one of the reasons that you would take the concern out of the app is because there are other apps you have to coordinate with. You're just saying there's a separation of concern, and even if this app is the only app that owns that database, you would still take that outside of the app.
Yeah.
Is it like, there's two apps running at the same time, but they're written different. They actually use the same database. So it's like today's version, next week's version, like conflict with each other.
Yeah. I'm just wondering if you could just do it with Liquibase and make it simpler.
Well, you wouldn't be able to roll that.
As long as the database changes are truly back compatible, it can be spread out over a longer period of time. But I guess I may not have run into the complexities that make you, want to separate those concerns.
Yeah. I mean, I think the presentation is kind of trivial to make it simple. A lot of changes you're going to do will be easier or not, just first thing, last thing.
Yeah.
But sometimes you really do have to clean up data, and it's hard to manage that.
And it is probably better to separate apps.
Sometimes when you have an active record or the base thing, you can have very loose database constraints. Other times. have to restrict those, right? So if you do have like not null constraints, it's bad if like a new application comes online and starts writing to a column while it's not going. And that's what you do. So you can always write everything forward compatible, but at some point you have to go back and delete the columns because they might be taking too much space or that kind of thing.
Yeah. Okay, do you have other questions, or?
Just to clarify, is that a database module a full-fledged app in its own right? Just like a sidecar standalone thing, or?
It is several separate module. It is not good to be part of the application. Yeah, it is separate app from CloudFoundry.
And further clarify that, you just tell the app to go to the different IP of the module, or the abstract module from the, SHA cluster, you just point it to the app IP opposed to the module.
It is not necessary to be also mapped to a route or to have an IP.
Perfect,
yeah. Yeah, but it should be on different address than the applications. The applications which serve some business functionality. Could you repeat?
The migration trigger.
Yeah, the trigger.
It triggered by a schedule or by a read or write operation.
It is triggered on reads and writes. Okay. by the applications. So for example, if we have actually only writes, if we have writes from the green version, which are writing data into the full name column, this data is populated also into the first name and last name columns. And we have one trigger for this stuff and another trigger doing the reverse stuff, which is coming from the blue version. Writing from the blue version to the first name and last name columns populate data to the full name column. Yeah, the reading is, we have the data there, which is properly migrated.
No, I'm saying that I'm just saying the trigger has to be both read and write. If you only have write, so let's say in the green side, you need to read a full name. But if that is already existing record, there's no full name, full name is empty. So if you read an empty record, right?
You mean the data which is not migrated yet?
Right.
Yeah. Then we read from the old columns.
The green also read from the old column?
One moment. The stuff here is that we migrate the data. We migrate the existing data is migrated.
Okay.
Then we push the green apps, and then they read only existing data. We cannot have.
Okay. Got it. Okay. So actually,
yeah.
We migrate the existing data. Okay.
Yeah. First, migrate the existing data.
That's a batch job.
Yeah. This is a batch job. Yeah. This is one of task.
Okay, got it. Right.
And then the triggers are doing only runtime migrations.
I see. Okay.
On writes.
Right. Yeah. Okay, got it. Right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you too. Okay. Do you have another questions? Actually. Okay, we are out of time. Thank you very much.
Thank you.